Baby, donde tú quieras, yo paso a buscarte. Tú espérame afuera, pa' si no llamarte. No traigas paraguas como quiera, vamos a mojarte.
Welcome back to Max Reaction. How are you doing today? Hopefully you're doing good. I am. Anyway, we're going to react to more real life lore. This is an awesome channel. They teach us so much about the world. Crazy stuff that you may not know. And this one's about how one man survived being lost 438 days at sea. That's 438 days at sea. That's way more than a year. I can't imagine. I think I would starve. I would dehydrate. I'd get ate by a shark. Pirates may kill me. I don't know. Bad things can happen out in the seas. How did he survive so long? I'm not sure. Let's check out the channel. Let's react to the video. Let's probably be amazed because this is the title alone is amazing. And then we will talk about it afterwards down in the comment section. So do not forget to watch the whole reaction and comment. Commenting is the most important part because that's my favorite part. I love reading what your thoughts are. So let's go ahead and check it out.
The Pacific Ocean is mind-bogglingly big. If you started here off the coast of northern Chile and dug a hole straight through the earth and came out on the other side, you'd discover that you'd still be in the Pacific Ocean in the South China Sea.
That's
the Pacific covers
about
one-third of Earth's entire surface,
one-third.
And it's bigger than all of the land on Earth combined. Except for a few scattered islands, it's also mostly empty, which means that if you're ever unfortunate enough to get lost here, there's a very good chance that nobody will ever find you, which makes the story of Jose Salvador Alvarenga and his rescue all the more fascinating. He currently holds a world record that he achieved on accident and that probably nobody wants to beat. The longest time spent being lost at sea. Against all odds, he somehow survived being lost for 438 days in the Pacific, so his record probably won't be beaten anytime soon. But how did he do it? The answers lie in how his misadventure began. In 2012, Alvarenga was an experienced fisherman in Mexico. On November 17th, he and another guy named Ezequiel Cordoba departed together on their small fishing boat from the tiny fishing village of Costa Azul on the Mexican Pacific coast. They planned to only work for a 30-hour fishing shift, so their boat was pretty small and not at all equipped for the nightmare that would come. It was basically a canoe with no roof or cabin, was only 7 meters long, and only had one small motor and a refrigerator for storing their fish. They knew that a storm was coming near the area, but fishermen in these parts of Mexico can earn enough money in a day to support themselves for an entire week. So they decided to take their chances and traveled 120 kilometers away from the coast to work. At 1 a.m., the storm hit them and was threatening to sink their boat. In a panic, the two men cut their fishing lines and dropped everything they catch and most of their gear overboard to make themselves more maneuverable. They were 6 hours away from the coast, so they traveled through the storm and the night in a desperate attempt to get back. By 7 a.m., they were only 24 kilometers away from the coast see mountains on the horizon. But then, awful luck struck them and their motor died. Without any paddles, oars, or sails, the unusually strong wind began pushing their boat back out towards the ocean. Their onboard radio still thankfully worked, however, so they frantically reported their position to their boss, who responded saying that he was coming, but their battery died and all they heard afterwards was silence.
Destiny, I guess.
Imagine the frustration that they must have both felt in that moment as their radio died and all contact with the outside world with it. And as they watched the mountains and the horizon that they were so close to slowly disappear as their boat that they were trapped on gradually was pushed back out into the vast abyss. Their boss did organize a search party that looked for them for days, but as their boat drifted further out into the vastness of the Pacific, it got harder and harder, so they eventually were forced to give up. Just 5 days later, the winds had already blown them 450 kilometers off the coast before finally settling down. They were surrounded by nothing but ocean in every direction, and their boat was so small they knew that they probably would never be spotted from the air. They had no flare gun or any other way to signal for help other than by waving, so they knew that their chances of survival were going to be slim. They had no supplies left on board, so they were forced to catch tiny fish or birds that landed on their boat with their bare hands for food. They grabbed plastic bottles that they found floating nearby them and used them to collect rainwater for drinking water.
But during long
periods of no rain, they were forced to mostly drink the blood of turtles that they caught with their hands or their own urine. Imagine going day after day, month after month, in a tiny box with only other person to talk to, and the only other ways to entertain yourselves being catching fish or napping. It's easy to understand how somebody could go insane under these conditions, which, according to Alvarenga's story, his friend did. The other guy, Cordoba, gave up hope about 4 months into their isolation and became suicidal. He got sick from all of the raw food that they were eating and refused to eat, and eventually starved to death. Alvarenga was then all alone in the middle of nowhere with no other human in sight as far as the horizon could see, a tiny speck inside of the enormous Pacific. And as you can see from this shipping map, the Central Pacific where he was somewhere at is a very quiet part of the world. Ships rarely come through this area, but even still, he claims to have encountered one when he was alone. A cargo ship apparently passed right by him and four men on board spotted him and waved. But they just kept moving past him and never even bothered to stop. Imagine how frustrated you would have been again if you were lost for months. You were all alone and you finally spotted rescue, but they just ignored you and kept on moving. 11 months in, and Alvarenga had traveled about 8,000 kilometers across the ocean in his tiny little boat. His clothes were shredded, and he only had a sweatshirt to protect himself against the sun. But finally, on the 30th of January 2014, he spotted coconuts bobbing around his boat and birds landing around him. He knew that land was near, and after drifting some more, he discovered an island that appeared to be uninhabited. It took him half a day just to drift near the shore when he finally jumped out of his boat and left its safety for the first time in over a year. He swam ashore and discovered a house, and when he knocked, he made contact with the first other humans since he left his village in Mexico 438 days ago, and after traveling nearly 11,000 kilometers. To put into perspective just how far away that is, imagine starting in a tiny boat in Lisbon, Portugal, and traveling less than 1 mile per hour until you drifted across the land to Hiroshima, Japan. Alvarenga ended up washing ashore on the Avon Atoll, which is the southern tip of the Marshall Islands and one of the most remote spots on the planet. Had he missed this spot, the next likely stop for him would have been the Philippines, nearly 5,000 more kilometers away. And since it took him 438 days to travel roughly 11,000 kilometers, it probably would have taken him about 240 more days to hit the Philippines. Fortunately for him, though, he somehow landed on this tiny, tiny speck in the middle of the biggest ocean on Earth and got himself rescued because of it. Later, he was flown back to his home in El Salvador, where he published a book and got himself sued by the family of his friend who died on the boat because they claim that he probably ate him. So, the lesson is, even if you survive more than a year stranded at sea, you could still end up getting sued over something that you may or may not have actually done out there. But if you're like me, and the ocean terrifies you so much that you'll never actually go, but you want to learn more about the terrifying scale and the weird creatures that live there anyway, you can learn more from the comfort of your phone or PC in your own home by checking out CuriosityStream next.
I cannot believe his friend's family sued him. The dude probably did eat him, but if he die, I don't think I could ever eat a person. I think I'd have to die before that happens. But the guy's trying to live. He's a survivor, obviously. He's drinking blood, drinking pee, scooping stuff out of whatever he could find to eat. And I just can't believe after a miracle happening, because that was an absolute miracle to last that many days. And I'm thankfully he hit that island, because the Philippines was that much more, that many more days. I'm like two-thirds more of a year away at the speed he was going, unless a boat or something finds him. And I can't believe that the big ship just waved at him and just kept going. I mean, they knew they weren't by land. They knew this guy wasn't supposed to be there, but yet they just pass on him. Come on, help a brother out. You know what I'm saying? Help a brother out. Like, this ain't normal, this dude out in the middle of the Pacific where there's no land, and you're gonna pass him and smile and wave. That's just heartless. That is just brutal, and hopefully that wasn't, bad intentions. Maybe they thought something else. Maybe they thought he was alright. Who really knows? But that's just insane. But those are my thoughts. What's your thoughts? Comment your thoughts down below. I'd love to read them. I love reading your comments. Also, request whatever. Request some videos. Put those down. I love reacting to requests. If you're part of the Max Reaction family, cool. If you're not, hit that subscribe button and become one of us. And don't forget to spread that peace, that love, that happiness wherever you go. And I will see you next time.
Baby, donde tú quieras, yo paso a buscarte. Tú espérame afuera, pa' si no llamarte. No traigas pa'